This is a Pinball News production.
I think the enjoyment increases the more your score increases. And so, another thing that's also fun is getting deeper and deeper into the game. Like, if Mark hit that hole up here on Paragon, that would have been awesome 5x bonus, and he almost did. And that's the excitement of the game, trying many times and not getting there, and finally getting there. So I guess that's why I'm here today. I guess that the biggest thing that I stress to people, because I give these talks, at least once a year, is there are three things you need to do to get big scores. One, know the machine you're playing, the rules of that machine. Play Paragon, you need to know how every single Paragon plays, rules-wise, and basically what to expect. If I hit this, this happens. The second thing is knowing exactly on a specific game. For example, we have two Paragons here. They would do things very differently, and they would need to be approached differently because the bounces, the rubbers, the play field, all of that will vary from game to game. And in a certain way, that might be the hardest adjustment to make. If you're playing at home, it's less of an issue. But if you're competing, going out in public, feeling things out on new games, it really helps to know. For example, on a game, the ball kicks out of a hole, like the electric chair. In Adam's Family, it kicks out in many ways, many Adam's Families. And that's something really important to do. If you want to keep the ball in play, if you want to set yourself up for shots, and if you want to score. So you need to know the rules of the game. And there are only a few hundred games you need to know. here. 240 games in the banks, which is amazing. Just knowing the specifics of each game. Sometimes it's actually harder to own a game and then play it somewhere else because you're so used to how you're
speaking. Hey, Andrei, I have a question for you. How do you adapt in a tournament whenever you only have three balls? How do you learn how to play a game or to figure out how to play a game is playing before you walk up? Did you just waste ball one just trying to test things out, or what do you do?
Yeah, I wish I could just waste ball one. One of the most important things to know how to do is to shake the machine without tilting. And certain tournaments have warm-up periods, like the finals of Pinburg have a warm-up period. And the first thing most players do, they shake the heck out of the machine to see where the tilt is. And once they find out where it is, what they're trying to do is figure out, okay, I need to shake it so much where it almost tilts, but it doesn't get there. So how do you do that when you're walking up to a game called Pinburg? There's a warm-up period, but not enough warm-up time to play 240 games. One really important thing is watching your opponents very carefully. You see someone shake the machine pretty hard, it doesn't tilt. Well, now you know you can shake the machine that hard and it won't tilt. You watch again how balls come out of certain places. When there's a brand new game, and I played a few that I've never played in competition before the last couple of days. Just looking at what maybe a more experienced player does, or a less experienced player does, and what's getting them scores. And so much of it's observation. You might not, when you play your ball one, it's your first time with your hands on the machine, you might be able to collect a lot of information from the players ahead of you. So watching carefully is a big part of it. There are also some great resources online, rule sheets, some beautiful videos that tell you how to play some of these games. I was playing Pinburg a few years ago, a guy hadn't played a certain game, so he watched some tournament footage, I think of Roller Coaster Tycoon, and then after watching it and listening to the commentary on his iPad during our match, that probably helped him figure out how to play it better. So there are some resources. I think the most fun and enjoyable resource is people you play with, if you play with others, and just going through a game and breaking it down. That's something I hope to do with this game that I've never seen or touched. Okay, I've touched it now. But
hey, you want to play?
Yes. But that exploration is a lot of fun. This is the oddest thing about pinball, in my opinion. Tennis, the top tennis player before they play a match, they don't go into the match saying, this is how you can beat me. But I'm at tournaments. For example, World Championships when Spider-Man came out, and I asked Jim Belzino and Bowen Kerins about their strategies on Spider-Man. because I didn't know well. And both of them gave me valuable information. These are my opponents. They're trying to beat me. And they actually gave me some good information on how to actually score points. And that's the nice thing about the pinball community. Everyone I've met through pinball just about are really nice, helpful, kind people. And the nice thing about the game is, hey, you're not really playing against each other. You're playing against the game. You're playing against gravity. You're just trying to get a higher score than your opponent. So those are some ways, I guess, when you come up to a machine for the first time, you can get some information. The third most important thing, I think, is knowing yourself. What are you playing pinball for? What are your goals? Do you want to be a hardcore tournament player? Do you want to play in leagues? Do you just want to play at home and get some scores up? Also, what do you like shooting? Now, there are some things you might like to shoot, like a beautiful ramp on Elvira. That doesn't give you a ton of points, Elvira and the Party Monsters, but it feels really good every time you hit it. Maybe that's what you want to do, but know yourself. And if you get into competitions, you really need to know your style, your strengths, your weaknesses, as well as your opponents as you get in on games. Because if you do that, you're going to be playing your maximum ability because you're playing in your comfort level with what your strengths are. So those are the most important things. The things I'm going to address today are the things that I get asked most often at these sorts of talks is, how do you score points? What are your strategies? And I'll give a broad overview and maybe a few specifics as examples. Another thing is, how to keep the ball in play. How do you not lose the ball? The other thing, which I don't do a lot of, but a lot of players do, and I think it's probably the best approach if you want to score more, is control of the ball, passing the ball, holding the ball, and shooting the ball. That's essential. If you saw any of the finals yesterday, there's some really amazing things going on. Keith Dunlap holding two balls on one flipper and playing with his third ball, a multi-ball, with the other. And these are really high-level sorts of things. Now, my area of expertise, I play a little more chaotically, but these are essential skills. Most things I'm going to cover today, you know, there's some, like I said, wonderful resources. Pinball 101, it's a great video, widely available. You can get it on iTunes. That covers a lot of things I'm going to cover, but also address your questions at the end. Maybe play a game and kind of talk you through it, just what my process is in feeling out the game and my approach, especially learning a new one, because I don't know, if I walked up to this at a tournament, I'd need to figure it out right away. Or if you walk up to it in a bowling alley, this might be a little too nice for a bowling alley, but you know, just trying to make the most of it.
How about taking me for a ride, big boy?
I have not played this game, but I love it already. Wow. I just want to just keep hitting this button and seeing what it says. Anyway, so we're going to start with Paragon. This is a nasty game. This is so challenging. It's really easy to lose the ball. I was playing a league championship game on here, and I won the final game with 25,000 points. Yeah. It's a good one to show some skills. But the first thing I want to talk to you about is holding the ball and aiming. Aiming is really important, of course. And basically, I want you to imagine the flipper is like this, and where the ball is on the flipper will affect your shot. If it's your right flipper, the later you hit it, the more it will go off to the left. The earlier you hit it, the more it will go off towards the center or to the right. The other thing that's really important with the aiming is the catch. So I'm going to show you catching and aiming as best I can. Hopefully I can get a handle on this ball. And this is Paragon. I'm going to baseball. If you're hitting a ball off of a tee, it's much easier to hit than when a pitcher is pitching it to you. Right now, this is like having it on a tee. You know exactly where the ball is, and the ball will consistently roll down the flipper when you release it at the same speed. I was talking to you about hitting the ball with the flipper earlier or later. So this makes it much easier to decide when to flip. I'm always going to have a consistent feed to my shot based on having it trapped here and starting from this position. Now, I've got some options. If I wanted to try to hit the spinner here, maybe I could backhand it. It's a tight shot. Maybe I want the Bolden Cliffs. Maybe I want advanced bonus. Maybe I want this gate. Maybe I want it in this gap so it goes in here. And I spell the word Paragon. So I have a lot of choices here. And so the first thing is, if you can do this, and sometimes you can do this on easier games than this, just by holding the flipper. And I'll show you some other ways to get it to this one flipper in a moment. But let's see, I'm going to take a shot here. So am I going to hit that early or later on the flipper if I'm shooting this game?
Later.
Later, of course. You got it. And so here we go. So that was a reasonable try. So that's really critical. What I want to do is bring in this guy. This is Bowen Kerins.
I'm already winning.
He's always winning. The only ones he doesn't win are ones like Timber. He doesn't play and he's signed up to. This is Bowen, five-time world champion, but also this guy's given a lot to the game. Some of you might have seen his instructional videos that show skills like we're going to discuss, but also specific games and game strategies. Bowen, welcome.
Valley of Demons.
And that's not to say, but you have a couple of options. And when the ball comes up here, you can use a little flipper, or you can let it pass down. And that has to be, that decision has to be made quickly. But it can help you decide what to do. And with this little flipper, you don't have to use the little flipper just to flip away. You can use the flipper to redirect instead. It's a very common thing that can be done with a couple of flippers that players do not think about a lot of time. Because surely you want to use a flipper, you flip with it. It's not the only thing the flipper can be used for.
With us on Paragon, we want the ball in control on the right side. Those targets, Bowen shooting, that's where you want to go. That's where the value is. It builds up your bonus
and your multiplier.
So what Bowen's doing is feeling out right now how to handle that ball as it's coming out of the Valley of the Demons. Maybe he's going to let it blow off. Maybe he'll hold that flipper up. Maybe he needs to hold that flipper up and give it a shove as well just to get it in the right position, left or right flipper. We don't know the specifics of the Paragon. We know we want to hit those targets on the far left to get our points, to get our bonus multiplier. We don't know how to do it safely.
I also learned from watching you that the ball is through here is likely to drain. So I'm going to give the ball an extra shove.
Nice.
Whenever it's there. That flip right there, I call it a chop flip. There's probably a better name for it. Flip really carefully on the very edge of the flipper. You can sometimes direct the ball straight up.
Yeah.
Post transfer, but from a moving ball, it gains control instantly.
Yeah, so I was doing that a little bit earlier when I was trying to settle it down, just whacking it up a little bit, either against the post or just straight up in the air and getting it to settle and slide down the face of this. Now, there's some really key skills. One thing, is post passing, you think that's an option on here?
Let's try post passing. There is post passing.
Yeah, there is post passing, and it's always hard to describe, but it's a matter of whacking this ball off of the post, then it bounces off the flipper to the other side. Again, if you want the ball to go the other side. Some games will allow you to do this, and others will not.
And it's also very safe, because if you fail, you're still on the same side instead. There's almost no way to lose the ball off the post pass. Find out. It's usually safe. Then you're trying to judge the timing of how early you need to flip. So you flip as early as possible, see what happens, and you die.
You see that? He just let the ball hit the flipper. That's a super important one, the dead pass. A lot of players are very uncomfortable doing that, and I don't blame them. You're actually letting the ball hit the flipper and not flip. Oh, he just backhanded. That was a very early shot we were talking about. From the left flipper, he got a target hit.
And here it's on the upper right flipper, which is the other place that can be. And here you generally have two shots, one to the Valley of Demons and one to the spinner. And the spinner shot is actually easier for this upper flipper than it is for the lower ones based on the angle of where the spinner is located. And with that 14,000 bonus, I know that internally if you get the 20,000 bonus, you get to keep it. So it makes sense perhaps to shoot the spinner at this point instead of shooting the Valley of Demons.
And he had the option to also let it drop to the lower flipper if you want to take a shot from there.
So that was worth 3,000 bonus, so I'm trying to get the 20.
Let's see the post
pass again.
Yeah, I mean, if it's
Will
possible.
Be good at it this time?
So the angle's not ideal.
But you can try again. And just again there, when it came to the right flipper, I wasn't trying to flip it away. I was just trying to deaden it and get it to the left to a controlled trap. Here's a bonus, yeah. There's a lot of ways that that can go successfully for you. That was a bad flip. That, trying to push it off of the upper flipper far enough to get to here. And I'm not flipping away from there because that's too out of control. I want it back over here so I can try the post transfer again. Once you get good at any kind of transfer, having the ball on either flipper is as good as having it anywhere. Because you can then move it to your desired location once you have control.
And this is going to vary from game to game. Some funhouse games, they're really good at post pass.
That was the best one yet. And I'm using here the gauge to push it back at speed so that it can get over and over. That's typically the post transfer on this game. Because the slingshot is further away, higher than on some other machines.
And like on funhouse, sometimes you can't post pass because the type of rubber they have doesn't allow you to. On other funhouses, it's a great option. Let's see if we can get that 5X.
bonus, and I made a little bit of a push on the left hipper. You see him coming towards the middle, one tactic is to just grab the machine and pull it in the direction you want it to go, and you'll be in about, I don't know, 60 an inch from that, maybe. That can be enough. And if that's enough, you can do that without causing a tilt. On some machines, that would have been a tilt on a tight star trip. On this game, you better be able to get away with that if Paragon is going to get everyone. So I know I can probably get away with that. So I'm ready with that or this for first center grains. That's not going to help you with all center grains, but for the really tight ones, the place where you're not sure if you get more than enough of them on it, that makes a difference. You know.
Yeah. One other thing he's talking about, you know, if the ball's coming down towards the middle, another thing you can do. A slap more than a shove. Well, oh, and by the way, we have someone else in this talk with us I'd like to introduce you to.
Hey, you want to play?
I don't know her name, but I like her. But as the ball's coming down the middle.
Is he petrol?
Yeah, maybe. As the ball would be coming down the middle, we'll demonstrate this later with the glass off. What Bowen can do as it's coming towards the middle, slap the machine. The tilt sensor is less likely to shake with a slap and hit the flipper at the same time. And so basically, the ball's coming near the flipper. He's shoving the flipper essentially underneath the ball to catch the tip of it and hopefully save that ball. If you do a shake or a shove, it's going to tilt. That's too dramatic. But the slaps, they don't seem to affect the tilt bob that makes you tilt quite as much.
When I first learned the slap save, I was not really taught, but I saw everyone using two flippers. You slap it away with one flipper, and that pushes it just enough to get to the other flipper, and then you flip away with the other flipper to direct it from danger. Over time, I've actually become more inclined to slap save with only one flipper for the reason of control. That second flip gets it out of danger, in that it's not going to go down the center right now. But it's immediately back into danger, and then you now have a ball flying away in a random direction that could easily hit something and go drain again. And players today this all the time, like, dude, I just made a great save, and then it immediately went down there. The problem, that means you did not make a great save. you continued to keep the ball in danger, and the ball went away. So if you're using one flipper, it's a slap save instead of two, you're more likely to gain control because you can get higher up on the flipper that second flip up and put you back out of control again.
Yeah, one thing, I learned this move from watching one of Bowen's tutorial videos, and I said, what in the world did he just do? He just slapped and saved with one flipper, and I've added that to my repertoire from coaching because it's a powerful technique. But now's a good time to stress.
A bounce over, I take my hands away from the gate. I don't trust myself. Not flip. If your hands are far enough away, you won't flip because you can't flip. You're making the decision, I'm definitely going to just bounce this over. And then you get ready again because you don't know how hard it is. You also want to know that the flipper is so bounceable. Every so often, the flipper is going to drop a little bit when the ball hits it, and that stops the bounce from happening. You have to be very careful about that. Watching opponents play, watching the first few flips of your own game in front of a machine for the first time, that's how you find out whether those bounces are allowable. Or the first bounce of a game, just be ready to flip it away if you realize, oh, it did bounce. Don't do it again.
Because every game's going to be different. Now's a good time to probably address what Bowen said about the one flip save. I think the most common error I've seen, two common errors, I think, for really beginner players. One is flipping unnecessarily with both flippers. You only need to hit the flipper that the ball is on. And, you know, there's some dangers that happen with that. Sometimes when you whack it, since both flippers are going up, you're hitting the ball with one flipper, and the ball hits off the other flipper. The only time you'd want to usually hit both flippers, a ball coming straight down the middle, and then we'll also demonstrate this with the glass off, and then hitting them at about the same time to push it out of danger. The rest of the time, stick with one, it's much safer, and you know, it's much more effective.
And do you want to talk about other transfer moves?
I'd love to do a tap pass.
You want to try the tap pass?
Yeah. All right. I love the tap pass.
I have an extra ball, so it's okay. You can take my turn.
Thank you. And if you want to tell them about the tap pass again, this is a game I want to go from left to right, and this would be my strategy, passing from left to right and then hitting these targets.
The tap pass is probably the most impressive skill you've ever in all of pinball. What you're doing is you're activating the flipper for a very short time, short enough that it does not go through its full cycle for a flip. And the just slight movement of what you see doing on the right now, that is enough motion on the flipper to push the ball over the center gap to the other side. Just enough that it deadens on the other flipper. And this is very delicate. So he's testing himself out on the right side to get a feel for where it is, and then hoping that the left side sensitivity is the same. There it is.
Whoa.
And if someone's doing a tap pass successfully, it's magic. It's like kind of telling you right now.
Oh, you lost my ball!
Timing of that is different than on almost every other game. So I pretty much got lucky there. But even alley past the edge where the two flippers meet is better than nothing, because you've got it on the far edge of the flipper to make a little better time to see.
One very dangerous move. It's got to be perfectly timed. It's kind of like the tap hat. If you do it too late or too weakly, the ball will go down the center.
So my tap passes are too weak right now. There we go. Then you get it back under control. It's post transfer. Yeah, I should have had that. You just slap save that.
Hey, you won a free game. Nice.
I got 40 again. You got 40 credits.
Now I think the live catch, can that be demonstrated here on
sure.
this kind of
truck? Sure.
You know, I think it might be a good time to take the glass off. We can set up some saves and also certain types of catches and passes.
Question, Bowen.
Sure, go ahead.
Do you find that tap passes are something that's something you can do on this or earlier error machines and not something on modern?
Timing is much more difficult on modern games just because the flipper actuation is faster. The speed of that flip going up and then dead end stroke is fast. And the timing you need to then cut it off, sort of at 20%, is really tight. Here it's already tight. But there's this video of this guy in Brazil making rolling tap fast on the scared stiff. He makes like 7 in a row back and forth. And the timing on the rolling tap pass is absolutely ridiculous. And the strength at which you have to roll the flipper is ridiculous as well. It's back and forth. I hope you never have to play against this guy. And we met him. He came to the IFPA World Championship. He was a great player.
I have a question about slap
phase.
It seems like whenever I try and do one, it hurts my hand. Does that mean I'm doing it wrong, or is that just how it is?
You may be hitting the lockdown bar, not the flipper. The position of your hand as you do it makes a big difference there, especially if you're putting your hand higher, like up here, towards the thumb, than at your flipper fingers.
What fingers are you hitting the flippers with?
I usually use the index and the middle finger to do so. I've seen some players. You didn't talk about stage flip, because there's two flips on the left side here. And you actually were able to do it with your tap back. Show the left tap again. The right tap. There. So. And there's two different actuation levels, one for the lower flipper and one for the upper flipper. And I've seen some people hold with one finger, like the actuation level four. Like on a whirlwind, it's there. And then use their other finger to hit the other left foot. I'm generally going to use both these fingers and then my thumb. This is on the machine. I'm slapping the finger like that. If you hit the lockdown bar on certain games, I know the Dovers comes to mind, the lockdown bars were a little bit shaved and they came from the manufacturer. And you can really actually injure yourself in half by slapping in a way to touch yourself against that bar.
But generally, it should
hurt. Apparently, it should hurt.
Yeah, this is what my slap looks like.
And you only need to move the machine an eighth to a 16th of an inch. And if you're showing it any further than that, it probably means that your timing is up. And you're reacting to something, going, oh crap! Wrong, but you should never really need to move the game.
How wide is the flipper?
Yeah. You should never need to move the game any more than half that distance. And you see some people going, bruh! And all that is just the reaction to being all time.
Live catch is a really...
Did you do a drop catch?
Everyone, do you know what? Drop catch is good too. I think drop catch and dead pass, those are two of the most critical skills to have. Maybe I'll do the drop catch. Yeah, now this is kind of the opposite of the live catch. Bowen will demonstrate. But what I'm going to do is, as the ball comes in, I've got the flipper up, but as it comes in, I'm going to drop it at the perfect timing, to really slow it down and almost stop on the flipper, or at least gently roll up here. This is a really nice thing to be able to do. It very quickly deadens the ball on the flipper that it's arriving on. So I'm going to be dropping it right about near the time it makes contact. On the left flipper. Maybe we'll go this way. This way might be better.
That was a little bounce there.
Now these rubbers are a little bouncy, so it's a little more challenging to do. Depending on the rubber, it'll be easier or harder. Well, that was easy. What Bowen's going to show is the live catch, and people love to see these at the talks because it's an extraordinary timing, dependent. Sorry to put the pressure on you.
Yeah.
So something like a drop catch is good when the ball is moving across the play field and then you drop catch. Now if a ball is coming towards the flipper, for example, from the loop on Theater of Magic, this is essential, from the loop, from the jet bumpers, on Green from the Black Lagoon, you need to time it perfectly, and let's see if Bowen can do this.
How about you drop it right from the top of this loop side? This one.
Okay. I'll try it there. And again, these flipper rubbers are real bouncy, but I have no doubt Bowen can do this.
Right.
Ready?
That's a little too early.
Come out a little farther out first, it'll come.
What is going on there? Yeah, it doesn't look like it's real, but you see it, so it has to be real. Is that the end of stroke of the flipper is canceling out the ball's momentum. And flippers have sort of this stroke and then this hold that keeps the flipper up without helping the coil down. And you're catching the very top of your flip at the same time the ball is coming at the same speed. Those cancel each other out, the ball stops dead right there. It's a drop catch is like a bunt in baseball where you are letting the bat go back and then deadening the momentum of the ball with your backward movement. A live catch would be like swinging the bat at full speed and then stopping your swing dead at the moment the ball arrives, and then having the ball just stop right there. That also gives you a sense of the relative timing of the two things. Drop catch gives you a measure of leeway in your timing because you are moving the flipper backwards at the time the ball arrives. Even if you're off a little early or a little late, it will still be generally effective. A live catch has very, very strict timing. Flip too early, your flipper will be raised by the time the ball gets there, it will be as though you didn't flip at all and just had the flipper raised up. If you flip too late, it will be a full flip away.
The nice thing is it's not as dangerous as the tap pass or the alley pass, because you are going to be striking the ball one way or another.
And these are relatively easy compared to some because the ball is slow moving, it's consistent. My starter are probably on Paragon or roll because the flipper over. That was not quite right, you saw a little bit of bounce. Close enough that it took care of it.
Any other kind of catching or passing? Oh, I was thinking, can you post-pass from here just to the other side? Because I think this is, and this is a post-pass. This might work better as far as demonstrating it, pushing it from here over to this flipper, off the post.
There, that was good. That was pretty classic.
So Bowen held out his dead pass there by shoving it while he was letting it hit off one flipper onto the next. So if it's coming in really slowly, that's an option. Just to shove it and make sure it gets over to that other side. Dead pass. Settling it down with those flips. What's he going to do? Alley pass. Does next. Dead pass. Trap. Tap pass.
And now usually you would just pick one of these in a game that you find is working very well for you or you're especially good with. Quite make a shot at the multiplier. That was a busted drop catch. Knowing what I knew from his play that the drop catch was very difficult because of these flipper rubbers, I should not have tried that. But the failure of that to work 100% is what caused that ball to break. It lofted off of that, and then it was basically dead. I couldn't save that little ball.
You know, one of the biggest questions I get from these talks is, what do you do when the ball is coming down the middle? You know, how do you do it? The thing I like to stress is sometimes something you do before it's coming down the middle is helpful, something preemptive. For example, let's pretend on this Paragon that whenever the ball happens to loop through here, you've noticed it tends to go down the center. Well, one thing you can do if that's the case, that was going towards the center. If you find that's happening, then what you do is preemptively give it a shove as it's coming through here. And basically you're hitting the ball off of here and pushing it out towards this flipper, as opposed to just letting it drain. So sometimes the things you can do to save a ball going down the middle happen before it even does. Let's see, Bowen, you want to just bump it as it's running through here. And let's pretend it's going to go down the middle if you don't.
Yay. No. It's the speed that caused that to happen. So if I throw it through there, see that? If I throw it through here, or maybe come off of here. If I throw it through there. Yeah. And it's so dependent that I actually don't want the ball coming through here at all. Because I'm not going to be able to figure out which way it's going fast enough. What I want to do is push this bumper up so that it doesn't even get there.
So much of expert play has to do with safety, control, repetition, getting the ball out of trouble preemptively, shooting shots that are safe and repetitive. And that's what he was doing there by shoving it off of here. You know, we talked about the golden cliffs. I know back home, if I don't flip the flippers crazy when this ball kicks out, and you have to time it with the clips, it will go here almost all the time. So there's a lot of preemptive kind of things you do. Bowen, how do you save a ball when it's going down the middle? You've done everything you can preemptively to stop it from happening, but that ball is coasting down. How do you approach that?
Well, you have to figure out which side it's going on and make the right adjustment with it to stop save. And more dangerous slap save, the harder you throw, you have to throw the game a little bit to get there. There's plenty of time where it's just not going to happen. In which case, if you screwed up by playing blow with you, that's been her. For example, hitting this advanced bonus target. One way to play Paragon or a lot of older games is to find the most dangerous shot and just say, we're going to try to hit that as many times as possible and score 1 point every time we hit it. What's going to help you do is going to help you make quick recovery. It's going to help you figure out where the ball is, why it drains, and it will drain, but it also gives you some quick recovery opportunities. Probably swim on the throttle.
Yeah, and then one other thing on this. This would be a time, Bowen's talking about the one flipper slap save, to hit both flippers when it's going down center. Look at the spacing between the flippers compared to this one. All right, compared to the size of the ball. This decreases the amount of space, especially when it's about halfway between the ball and the flippers. You hit both, you got a pretty decent chance of hitting it unless it's coming straight down the middle. So that's one time you do it. If you notice it's going a little more to the left, you hit this one first, and a split second later, you hit the right one. We got one question, and then we'll move on to the full throttle. Yeah, you had your hand up for a while.
What factors go into your decision between a drop catch or a live catch? Is it the angle of the ball coming in, or is it one of you just better at, or?
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of it's the angle. A lot of it's comfort level. Some people don't live catch. I think most of the serious players do drop catch. But like, if it's coming in this way, you can sort of do something of a live catch, but not as easily because the angle. It'll be more of a swipe that'll pull the ball up here when it's coming in this way. Again, like a live catch is best when a ball is coming in from the same side of the flipper, like from a loop. You're going to see Bowen show a lot of these control skills on this new game that we've never played. So this would be good for a live catch. This would be better for a drop catch. So, where we start one more.
How about taking me for a ride, big boy?
What do you say? Shall we take it for a ride?
Big boy.
So we got a mic here, Bowen. You're vested, you know, doing this and then while you're playing. So Bo and I, we're going to explore this game. We're not just going to, you know, shoot shots and show off skills, but just the process of figuring out what we want to shoot for, what's worth shooting for. And Bowen does this all the time. He's got some wonderful videos at the papa.org site. I mean, so many. Plus, there are rule sheets that tell you what to shoot at. Have you ever played this game before?
I have not played this game before.
I have not either. And so we'll take turns playing it, exploring it. It looks beautiful. Getting it going.
Hi, I'm Bowen, and we're going to play some Full Throttle today. Two players. All right. All right, so it looks like we got our Rev the Engine skill shot.
Rev the Engine.
Okay. Oh, okay. So again, first thing you want to do is just get control, and now I can take a look at what's on the play field. And first thing is, you see something flashing, it's probably worth a lot. I've got motocross, street advance, drag advance, motocross, circuit, and the green light lock. And a center shot that says start race, which looks important. So I'm going to try to get the ball to the left flipper and shoot that hole first. And it looks like I can do that by shooting this right ramp. So send me over to the left. I'm trying to shoot the center. There we go. That wasn't bad. Good race about to start. Two, one. Go, go, go. Ah! Okay. All right. Let's see. There's a live catch on the right there. So now that I have control, I can see where I'm going for. Next shot. Oh, timer. Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Next stop is Brian Dominey. We're going to take him down. Let's backhand that. Right ramp, maybe. Right loop. That's a tough shot with that. It looks like tap passes are possible. I'm trying to make the right ramp, the right loop here, but it wasn't working for me. That looks like a place to just hold the flipper up to get control. That's a bad shot. So I'm shooting way too late.
Nice shot there, Paul.
Thanks. All right, have we got time to make any more? Okay, next shot value. There's a checkered flag. I don't know where that's sending me. Did I win? Woo! Take that, number six, whoever you are. All right, garage lock is ready. There's the green lights. I'm finding that this shot I'm missing every time I go for it. And the one I'm missing it by hitting it to the left. That means I'm flipping too early. And the fact that this is a wider body than a typical play field is maybe having an impact on that. So I just have to know that and be ready for the next time I take that shot. All right, looks
green
like.
Green lights are very often locks. That's how you get the multi-ball.
So let's try for locks some more. Garage is open. Instant award. Ooh, advanced street.
Yeah.
I got a street now. Okay, so let's see if we can get in a multi-ball. Multi-ball is a great strategy on the very first time you're playing a game because you can get used to where things are much more easily when there are balls in play. I'll try the right loop again, even though I failed at it before. Shoot it later. And I'm still too early. Even though I'm shooting it much later than I'm used to, I'm still too early every time. And I just got to get it. You got to get it into your brain.
You know, outlaying, Bowen said something really interesting about outlaying.
Still too early.
You want to do when it's going towards the outlane. You want it to even go near the in lane. These are on the outside. You want to shove it. Ball comes out of the outer area on the outside. up and in the direction of the out lane will push that ball out.
Your turn.
Oh, really?
You want the mic?
You can talk through, but I'm not going to be doing anything strategic.
All right. Well, I blew your skill shot. Now, if there's anybody great at shooting stuff, it's Andrei. Andrei is an incredible flow player. So even though a lot of what we demonstrated is skill moves, the choice of just taking reactive shots and just plowing through, especially in multi-balls where there are three or four balls in play. And see what I mean about that right loop? It's just a difficult shot, and I'm not sure what I'm doing there. But that reaction is something that makes Andrei an incredible player. I would probably not have been able to see that ball fast enough to make the right flipper reaction that he did there. And he's making a choice there to bump to prevent it from going too far over to the right. Making them shots. Oh, you get combos here. All right, so if you make two or three shots consecutively in a short time frame, it looks like you get more points for the consecutive shots. Your shot value now is like 2 million instead of 600,000. Also, your last name is Two. Octane is ready. Octane is ready.
Oh, it is ready.
Octane is ready.
I got the octane.
You did? No, I don't think so. I think you just got O. What's a garage?
What's
a I think he runs the other company, Garage CERN.
Trying to get the locks here.
And you can see now those little spinners on the wheels on the right were active for a while. I think from the shots he's been making. So there are those four spinning discs. That was crazy. Alright, shoot for a race. See? Good shot. So one of the things that appears to happen in this game as well is there are these shot challenges, it looks like, on each of the five major shots, the street, the motocross, etc. And it looks like if you make enough of one type of shot, you'll get a reward for that. Somewhat similar, it looks like, to the style of Monster Bash or Attack from Mars. And that stuff over there, we're brand new to the game. It's a nice ball. This area over here is different from a typical in-lane, out-lane area, with the middle lane being the troublesome spot. So the decision you make about where to send that ball is different than it is on a normal machine. You've got two right in-lanes which make that easier, or you'd think, except Avatar.
What the heck is that?
Pull down left to right flipper to rev the engine, launch ball in the amber zone, whatever that is. Oh yeah, skill shot! Ball save, ball save. Use your ball save wisely. I got an instant award.
Nice, the modern game will give you the ball back and use it really quickly.
Okay, so it looks like, for example, I have one left for Moto Challenge and one left for Street Challenge. And Street Challenge is, let's see, right ramp is lit for Moto Cross. Let's try that. Sweet! This looks cool. There's the street challenge. Oh, sweet! This is cool. Alright, so what's happening, it looks like, is every time you finish one of the challenges, you get a badass song, and you get a playfield multiplier. There's three balls in play, and I can actually finish another challenge and get another ball in play and a bigger value. But every shot is worth whatever.
Yeah, what you're seeing here too, Bowen is going to also demonstrate some beautiful techniques. He's got three balls on one flipper. He's going to find a way to play it under control. He'll probably be keeping one or two balls on one of the flippers while he plays with the other. He just separated one out. Now he's going to hit shots. He's totally safe on the left side. Those balls aren't going anywhere until he needs to save a ball or until he loses this one.
And there, you don't have to do anything a lot of the time. A lot of the time you can just...
had to flip there to save that ball.
Not every player will flip there. Some players will just eat it and go back to two balls. I actually think that the number of balls in play may control the value of shots here. So some games, you have triple scoring when there's three balls in play and double scoring when it's two. So you have a monetary value in keeping more than two in play. Yeah. Oh, that's trouble. Should have been able to do something about that. Cradle separation. Okay, and I want to keep this going, so I want to. That was dangerous, but I thought that would happen, and it did. Yeah, what I want to do is separate this and then shoot this one mark circuit, because I need two more shots for that. Stunt is also available on Captain Ball, but I don't know that shot yet. Ah. Jackpot! Okay. You know, what I'm finding is that shot for me is much easier from the right. Ooh, wow. That was fast. Sweet. All right, one more for stunt. Ah, come on. Play better. Stunt, circuit. Oh, come on. Oh, shooting too early now. All right, trying to backhand this captive ball now. That was not even close. But I got the other shot. Oh, when the things are going too, dang it. I didn't even notice that. That's too bad. All right, let's get three locks going and play the other multi-ball. Bonus times four! All right, what other questions do you have? What would you like to see here? Thanks. There is one. It doesn't have a higher play field angle. It's just fast. The ball is moving fast. The flippers are much stronger than they are on Paragon. It's actually almost the same level, angle probably. Maybe off by a degree, but what's causing this game to be much faster is the kickouts are strong, the flippers are strong, the ramps are strong. This is just a big difference between the 70s era games and the modern games. One of the things that makes Pinburg such a difficult tournament to play well in is you're constantly going back and forth between games of these different eras. And you got to play AC/DC and then Miso back to back. And there couldn't be two different games, but there are skill sets on each, and a great player has the skill set across the board. Go ahead. So question about when you're doing a two-handed slap save, your second hand momentum is killing the move of the first hand against the tilt bob. And I know some players who are great with this. Andy Rosa does some moves on the machine where I'm like, that has to tilt. And somehow he just knows like what he can do and when and the timing of those jiggle saves. I'm not good at that. So I can't tell you very much about doing it. I know that rocking it back and forth, you tend to be able to get away with some things that you might not otherwise, which can be surprising at times. And Rosa can do these jiggle, 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 jiggle. He's moving the machine like this for a good 3 or 4 seconds to get the ball back into play. And you're like, really? What? But he just knows. He's that good at those moves. And most of the time, if I make a move like that, it's out of desperation because I've already made a mistake that sent the ball into the outlane area, and then I'm forced to just say, all right, I'm going to lose if I don't try this, bleh. And then every once in a while it works. Most of the time it doesn't. You don't lose anything by trying to make those saves in match play because if you're last and use tilt, you're still last. And if you're last and you don't tilt and you get the ball back, you could be not last. And you at least get to feel awesome for a few seconds because you saved the ball. Do we stop? Should we continue? What's our timing like?
What is our timing like? I know Mr. Highway's here to show off this game.
I want to get the multi-ball, so you tell me when to stop. All right.
Bowen's yeah. Kind of guy who can take it through bases and probably get to the end of the game, no doubt.
All right, so where I am now, I have the green lock is ready, so let's go for that.
This might be multi-ball.
This is multi-ball! Full throttle multi-ball. That's a good. Get all the jackpots like Super Jack. That I can do, or I can try to do. Actually, I'm not sure I'll be able to make that right orbit, but I could try. Jackpot. Hey, what are those numbers? Why are the commas all the way at the top like that? What is this? What country is this? Here we go. Two, blah, blah. Just kidding. Sorry. I did get this multi-ball from shooting the garage, so it makes sense, actually. Okay, so I'm trying now to learn the timing on that little inner loop on the right. There's another transfer that was below busted, so I'm down to two balls. What I want to do is use these targets here, actually, to push the ball off the targets to the right.
And I'm kind of curious, like, rules-wise, he's got this green flashing light in the middle, question mark, says mystery race when lit. Does he get that for draining? I don't know. Fascinating. And maybe it's just flashing because it's a multi-ball. Just making the game more exciting.
I couldn't get that. So let's try to see if we can get an add-a ball in the last second here. Oh, this is a different challenge. It's the stunt challenge. Okay. Yeah. No! No ball save.
Didn't get the cut this time.
Yes. Yeah. Shut up. Okay. And that's the same kind of move you do on Paragon to get the ball out of that beast area. A little push up because you got to push it over that gap.
One thing strategically to do sometimes too, on some games, you start a mode. For example, you start a scene in the new Star Trek game, you fight against Nero, and then you start the multi-ball. And then you have a mode going at the same time. That's called a stack. So sometimes Bowen and I, we might choose not to start a multi-ball that's ready, because we want to start something else that we can play together with the multi-ball.
Excellent point. Oh, I should have saved that. I know it's a looser tilt than usual, so I should have had that. That was crazy. That's you, player two. You got 43 million to chase.
43.
That's right. Which might be awesome. I don't know.
I know Bowen best because he like almost always beats me.
Andre and I played a best of nine match at the IPA 5 World Championship, and it went to nine games.
And the year after that, we did the same.
The year after that, we played again, best of nine, and it went to nine games again. And it's just amazing to watch the style and the differences. You get the chance to just watch Andre play F-14 Tomcat sometimes. His decisions and his strengths of being able to play three balls like this with on-the-fly moves and decisions. This is stuff that I can't do. Wait, what did I have? 43 million? I thought I had a good score. Yeah, 44 million to 57. Now this is an opportunity to mention something in the pinball lexicon. Usually if you're player two on the last bowl and you've won, you stop because you won. There's a certain player who generally does not do this. And so when you continue to play ball three after winning the game as player two, we call that Massenkoffing. And we've asked Andre about it. It's not that he doesn't, he's wanting to show up the other player or anything like that. He's just like, I got a ball of pinball that I could play. I'm going to go play it. Congratulations. You kicked my butt there, man. Nice job. There's a big benefit to being a later player in a game because you get to learn from the mistakes the first player made and say, oh, that's how the ball drains on this one. I'll make sure I watch out for that. Go ahead.
Can you talk a little bit about stance and body English? Because I think I've seen feet in every possible position.
Hopefully not every position. But yes, it's amazing how everyone sort of adapts their own style. You see some players who are just very stoic and standing there. Keith Elwin is a prime example. A player we know is Mark Conant in the Bay Area. He is the stoicest of all. He puts his leg up against the inside of the machine and uses his leg as leverage and allows him to move the game several inches at times without tilting. For example, he put a billion on Whirlwind using that.
It's amazing all the different styles. Bowen is fun to watch. If you ever watch Fish, you don't see his body, but he moves around. Whereas Keith is up like this. Lyman Sheets, he's down low. Now he's got like kind of a view at the level of the play field, so he can really aim at shots. Whereas Keith, he has a bird's eye view. And so, you know, sometimes you might actually want switch up your stance. I know on Theater of Magic, I like to shoot the center ramp over and over again to get these combo millions. And when I do that, it's really important for me to see the exact spot on the flipper I want to hit the flipper on, the ball on. And so I'll stand up here and see that spot. Other times on Demolition Man, there's this top left loop that'll start your multi-ball. In that case, I get down low, try to visualize the spot I want to hit. But everyone's got a personal style. And just find what works with you. You can experiment with things too, and just see what's more comfortable, what's more effective.
I agree with Andre that trying to vary your stance, you're going to find more about what you like. People tend to play their one stance, and I was very much an upright player for a while, and I find now that I get into a position like this when I know I'm in recovery, because it makes it easier for me to recognize and make a skill movement. I won't even have my hands on the flippers necessarily in that, because I know the most likely thing to come next is a nudge. And so my body tends to be a little bit all over the place because you're changing what your goal is at the time and you're making the decision about where your body is positioned for that. But everyone has their own style. And, is it Dunlap? I'm not doing it right, but... No, Dunlop isn't putting his knee in. He's just putting his back leg down as far as possible. And it's kind of like, a little more like this. It's a little Lyman-esque as well. But it's amazing how many different styles there are. Go ahead. Okay, this is a good question. This is very important for improving your skill over time. A lot of drains that occur are slingshot slam drains, and you know the slingshots are built to kill your ball. They're on purpose. So that is built to send your ball to the right out lane. This is built to send your ball to that left danger area. And what you have to know is, as the ball is coming, where is it going to go after if you do nothing? You almost have to know that before it hits the slingshot. And if it's going here, my favorite move is to push up. By pushing up as it hits the slingshot, you're influencing the ball just a little bit, so it'll go higher into this rubber instead of that post, into the danger area. Or on the left, it'll go up into the octane targets instead of over by the letter R. I don't want the letter R. The letter R is dangerous. I want it never to go in that area at all. If it's over in that area, I've already made a mistake. I might be able to get it back, but it shouldn't go there. I mean, obviously every pinball ball will end.
The slingshots are not your friends. I was playing a tournament 2 weeks ago, though, and I found that the slingshots, the way they went back and forth is, generally, a dangerous thing that'll happen with some is, you know, they'll just go out, or they'll go back and forth, higher and higher and higher, and then out. But this one I found that it just gently went back and forth and eventually came down.
Lower, lower,
so
and
just
lower.
Let it be. So there are times, too, again, you're feeling out that individual game. In most cases, though, that shove forward comes in really handy.
And the danger part is if you shove forward when it was going too low, you're now putting into the danger area instead. I think the only way to learn this is to do it and fail. Just nudge a lot, and you're going to learn what happens. And also just know that each machine is different. Each instance of a machine is different as well. So things you expect to work are not going to work, and you have to make immediate adjustments to your play as you play. That is the biggest thing that I think takes a player from being good at home, good in an arcade, to good in competition.
Yeah, one thing, you know, I like to use this example. There's a fun house game that was in the tournament. Normally when I play fun house, talking about, I like to shoot into the mirror, but the mirror shot is so tight here at Pinburg that it's too dangerous. I'm going to hit it one out of maybe seven times. And so normally that's my strategy, but if I were playing that tournament, I would adjust it. And then I found out that the nice thing I could do is hit the left ramp and work towards locking a ball and multi-ball, getting the ball to come down here, passing the ball. And by the way, this is a very easy pass. Ball's rolling down an in lane. If it's going fast enough, just holding up your flipper will allow it to go over the other flipper. That's one of the easiest passes. Just hold your flipper up. Again, it needs enough speed. But anyway, discovered, okay, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to shoot that left ramp. I'm going to deviate from my plan because that's how the game is playing. And that's the kind of adjustment you need to make to any new game you come on, even if it's a game you're familiar with. You have a usual way of playing it.
What else?
I got a question. Bowen, you said in your tutorials that the best way to keep it from going on an out lane is not letting the ball go over to the out lane. Mm-hmm. But sometimes that ball is going to go there.
You made a mistake.
is it better to let it make that first bounce at the out lane or just immediately shove on first contact with that area?
There's no yes or no answer to that question, because the first contact can be the worst contact. It could be off the wall and into the in lane. If you do nothing, and then your extra move caused it to bounce a little more off the in lane rubber and back to the out lane again, and then your move cost you. So there's no right answer. I think that overall, moving the machine hard is better than not moving the machine at all, because you're giving extra momentum, and the momentum makes things more likely to go in your favor. The ideal when it gets to the in lane out lane area is out altogether. So if you have any opportunity to get the ball pushed outward off a post or a rubber, that is almost always a positive. Even if it means up and to the left, and that's got potential to hit something else that then sends it out, that's usually positive. But so dependent on the machine that there is no right answer. And if there was, we would still be playing yesterday, Friday.
A lot of these things we're talking about, we've been doing for a long time. Adjusting to a shot, shooting it earlier or later, or all these moves, these passes and stuff. For you, if these are things that are new to you, it will take some time to develop a comfort level. Once you do, they'll come more naturally, and I think it'll be hardest at first, but satisfying once you make that post pass, or once you make that first live cast. But it does take a lot of time. You do it enough, though, it becomes second nature, and you don't have to think about it. You just need to think about, what shot am I going to hit now?
I don't know if Andre got a chance to discuss this, but an inspection of the machine before you begin is critical. If you're playing a machine for the first time, or a machine, even if you know the machine well, the one you're about to play could have the right outline post removed. And suddenly the gameplay has changed significantly because of that. It could have a metal center post instead of a rubber post, or the post is gone altogether. I got eliminated from a Papa 1 year. Terminator 2, when the ball's going towards the center, and I just had, I didn't remember in my brain in that moment that there was no center post. And I said, oh, it's going to hit the center post, and then you're done. You're done. You're out. Go ahead. Ew. What do you mean by that?
Like most games that I've encountered have the tilt off on the left side, and sometimes when you're doing it like multiple times, you tend to get the get that bob moving. So I was wondering if it's a little safer to do it on the right side opposed to the left side.
I haven't learned anything from that, so I don't know. There are probably some other players who have an answer to that. Do you know anything about this?
Yeah, our Paragon back home in San Francisco, it allows you to shake it more and put more force on the right than on the left. And maybe that's more dramatic because it's a wide body game and that distance means more. But like bowling, it's extraordinarily rare where I learned that working one side more than the other makes a difference. One interesting thing though, sometimes certain games, you gotta be alert. Sometimes they'll let you shake side to side. Sometimes they'll let you pop it forward. And there's a variability of what type of action, what direction of action they'll accept as well. Just the way they're set up. And it's just fun feeling them out and discovering them, just like we gotta discover this game for the first time.
Okay. Anyone else? Yeah, there's... the best way to get comfortable with skill moves is to stand next to someone who's better than you for a long time, like Neil Schatz, and watch Neil do things over and over again and realize this is why that works and this is when that works. Barring that, this is actually one of the reasons I think that Papa decided to create the video archive, both of gameplay videos. I mean, there's the tutorials, but the tutorials are less than 10% of the videos. Mark Steinman and others at the Papa facility have 5 to 10 minute videos of just good gameplay on almost every machine that Papa has, and almost every game that was in Pinburg, for example. So you can at least see, like, this is what is possible. Some of the more advanced skill moves, like tap passing, except I'm still not comfortable tap passing in a competitive play after 20 years. I'll do it if, in like worst case scenario, where all of the other passes are not working, and I realize, all right, fine, I gotta try to tap here. So I'm not comfortable with everything. So we did that on the Paragon. We called it an alley pass. And the move there is to take, say, the left flipper and just time a very late flip and then drain. Time a very late flip into the alley between the flippers. You can try it on a highway as well if you want. It's so difficult. It's actually probably easier on this game on Throttle than it would be on Paragon because of the orientation of the lanes.
The larger the spacing, the easier it should be. But also it depends on flipper strength and also what type of rubber you have there. Again, making that adjustment to each game.
Other questions? Overall, the type of flipper rubber, and there are many different types. It's another one of those places where you are adjusting to the play that you're handed. So, for example, that Paragon, the fact that we were unable to drop catch on that would be very relevant to play, because I use the bottom right flipper to drop catch, and then fire immediately into the multiplier. Knowing that I can't do that on this machine would make me change my strategic decisions. And I have to figure out as quickly as possible what that is doing. I don't know with the band types or styles whether there are certain things easier or harder than others. I know I've noticed that bounce overs are a little easier on a lot of games now, and it deadens the ball enough that you can then catch it on the other side. And that live catching has become more difficult on some of the newer rubbers. But it's not to say that, I've heard many times people like, it's stupid Superbands, and then Simon's just like, these are brand new rubbers. These aren't Superbands at all. These are a real thing. So player's impression of what they're being handed may impact that as well, where these things may actually be behaving the same, and we just think they're different because we know that there's some manufacturer. I mean, the quality of these things and their durability is incredibly relevant to location play and home play. Not home play so much, because at home you don't play 50 games a day, but on location, the ability to have these things that last a year instead of a month is outstanding.
And they don't have a lot of the residual junk that comes off of them and dirties up the play field. For me, the post passes seem to be harder to execute with the Superfan Tom.
Yeah. And that's related to the bounce over being easier, because it's a situation where the deadening is happening a little bit. But yeah, I don't really notice this. I just start playing the game. I'm like, well, that's not working. That's working. Okay, let's focus on that. And in a competitive environment where you're especially playing only one game on a machine, you want to find something that's working and work it as quickly as possible. And if that means you find what another player is doing that's working, and you just steal their idea, do what they're doing, it works. You're still going to have some success from that. Don't try to do what you can do at home on every game, because it's not going to work. And my world, I often fail very badly on a World Cup soccer in competitive play, because I have one at home, and I figure, okay, this is where this ramp is, this is where the goal is, this is, and then all of that stuff gets shaken up just enough that your play is ruined on another World Cup. Go ahead. I ended up playing Neil Schatz on a game called Gladiators, and there's this flipper at the top that can make one shot very easily over and over again. Neil started the game by just shooting this shot about 40 times. And then he's like, this is ridiculous. This is only worth $25,000 a shot on a game where the replay is $200 million. He'd gotten up to $1 million at that point. So it would only take him another 3,000 of these shots to get a good score. And then finally he's like, this is ridiculous. All right, and he started playing the game normally. Later in that tournament, we discovered there was a round where you could make that same shot for $3 million a shot. And it was an infinite timer until you lost the ball. And that changed things quite a bit on that game, because now those 40 shots were worth $120 million instead of $1 million. And at that point, you do just sit there and go as far as you can with it. If you want an example of this, you can watch the rebroadcast of last night's Pinburg final and watch the game of Who Done It.
And Bowen did this great on a Doctor Who game, 2007 Papa. They had to replace the original game, which was set up harder because it malfunctioned. They put in another Doctor Who. And Bowen tore it up. $1.5 billion. All he kept doing was hitting side ramp 10 times and then spelling the word Who. And it's very effective. And, you know, he's building it up to 40 million points a shot. You know, that's one of those spots. It's kind of boring to watch, but it's exceptional skill that it takes to actually nail those shots over and over.
And the end of that story is that in the next round, Jorin Engelbrechtsson did it even better than I did. He got $1.7 billion, and then he was the world champion that year. I don't know what our timing is about bugging out. Should we stop? When do we stop?
1:00.
Yeah, it's 1:30. So we've been asking, like, when do we get off? So I'd give apologize to Andrew. Thank you for making a really fun game to play. Appreciate all of you being here and any questions.